Because actually every song he's ever done, he always doing some music. Most of the time the music, occasionally the words. And then he adds some music creatively. And some artists get both, you know, song complete, more or less as is. You know, say like she dreamt her whole album.
How would you even think about an artist dreaming about songs? That's amazing.
I guess stories just started coming to me more and more, and that part of it. I actually dream music plenty. I certainly dreamt it a bit, you know, a very clear soundtrack kind of to the dream before. And then as I started writing, I think like anything, once you get interested and start focusing on it, I was having musical dreams, multiple ones every night. And now kind of like on demand. So I think it's there. And didn't you mention to me once that you dream lyrics, right, when you're practicing for your shows?
No.
Oh, I thought you said that sometimes you're practicing dreams of the different the words and the lyrics or something. Sometimes people are sort of rehearsing in dreamland before the actual physical performance, so that they get it right. Either the voice or the skills, or sometimes just the lyrics.
We're going to play some music that you call your direct from dream music mix. So I'll tell you what it is, tell us a little bit about it, we'll play it for a little bit, and then come back and talk more about it. And I'll touch on the list you gave me. But the first is Lucid. So tell us about this one. So we're going to play the whole song of Lucid. What is that?
Oh, okay, great, thanks. So I guess that was early on during my head, and it's an interesting principle behind it. So I guess you'll see a little opening, I guess they call it the hook, wherever I've been in my life. And I just woke up with that little hook on in tonight. Yeah, developed and recorded. But once I started working on it a few months later, you know, I played with it, like I date somebody a little bit before you go steady. Then when I went steady and I started working and producing it, I dreamt more like the arrangement of electric guitar distortion. It's kind of like once you commit to something, then you get the next installment, the next impact.
All right, let's play Lucid a little bit, then you can tell us about it, who's singing it, but I guess it's you, okay?
Yeah, you're singing it.
Right. Here's Lucid. Wherever I've been in my life, I've never felt as good as when I'm with song, so we're not playing the whole song, but now you thought of the lyrics and the music in a dream?
Yeah, and also sort of the tone of it, like, I was more of a classical folk, you know, guitar voice, and then this really strong distortion guitar came through, and I was like, okay, I guess I'm going for my electric, and, you know, tried to put it together, but like Billy Joel says, I can never really recreate what I hear in the dream, I just kind of do my best as an artist.
Didn't Beethoven and Mozart dream their music?
A dreamer, and even after he was deaf, Beethoven was getting tuned still, so some kind of inner hearing is still working great. Mozart was a visual dreamer, a big synesthete. He said, I could see the whole composition completely there in front of me, like a beautiful big, I guess, portrait or picture or something, maybe a crystal. But he knew that, yes, later I'll have to write out the parts separately and record it and have them teach all the musicians. So you could see it all visually in one shot, which is kind of interesting.
Now that's what is called morpheon. What is that?
Morpheon. Yeah. There's a little hint there because the word neo is backwards at the end of that, morpheon. And that was actually for the soundtrack of The Matrix 3 that I was submitting for that. But it shows a few dreams are included in that one. It shows a trend that I always dream in descending sort of three note sequences. So you'll hear that a whole bunch.
All right, let's listen in on morpheon. Their dreams?
Well, the that's what I found very interesting. I'm glad you asked. There's something like what I would call metadata, that sort of, when you see it statistically, that comes together. There seems to be this trend of ownership uncertainty.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of musicians said, wow, I didn't create this. Where did this come from?
Who gave it to you? Yeah.
Yeah. And, but later on, they realized, oh, okay, I guess, but I guess it's mine. Bono, author Richard Bach, James Cameron had that about some of his ideas. There seems to be a very interesting trend, I guess, a little bit. If you record it, or even start working on it right after the dream, some musicians, even in the middle of the night, like Lenny Kravitz, you'll wake up and record it right there, best they can, at least take two or three takes. Then you seem to get a more clear, accurate, and I guess, version of what was in the dream, or another little trend. And then you start to see groupings of people who kind of run together. There's sort of, I don't know, some inner teamwork that Jimi Hendrix seems to show up in a lot of living guitarist dreams, helping them learn guitar.
Really?
Yeah, Stevie Ray Vaughan had Jimi Hendrix teach him secret chord changes, and his wife said in the same interview, you know, I saw him lying there in bed, and he was scrunched up on his face, and he had his pick in the hand, and his, you know, stretch, I guess his fingering hand, all out there stretched as he was playing. So maybe learning during sleep, taught by a master.
We're friends with Billy Gibbons from ZZ Top, and the next time we talk to him, we're going to ask him about his dreams, to see if he's dreamt any of his songs.
And you mentioned maybe John Fogerty.
John Fogerty's a good friend of ours.
That'd be great to hear about their stories. And also any listeners who might know of artists, obviously there's many in the book that we haven't mentioned, but there might be some new ones that I'm not aware of, because I'm having people contact me all the time.
So I'd love to hear new stories
and try to find a way to include them in power. It's something that people share. In fact, one of the close listeners from my first show we ever did about this, was included in the book as yet.
No, that's good. We're going to take a quick break, Craig, and come back and take these promised calls next on Coast to Coast Station.
Now you can get show updates and connect with other Coast fans when you join the Coast to Coast AM Facebook page. Just go to facebook.com/coasttocoastam and click the like button.
The Cognitive World Podcast takes you back in time to 1993 for the ultimate Bernice World Rewatch, with members of the original cast.
None of us have seen an episode since it aired back in the 90s, so we'll be witnessing our middle part haircuts, putting t-shirts, and teenage overacting for basically the first time right along with you.
Listen to Cognitive World on the iHeartRadio app or wherever you get your podcasts. Brought to you by DuckDuckGo. Search, browse, and email privately, all for free with the DuckDuckGo app.
COVID-19 vaccines help keep our families safer from the risks of COVID-19. Now, children 6 months and older are able to receive the same reassuring protection. As a parent, you might have questions or want to find out more about COVID-19 vaccines for kids. And that's okay. Talk with your doctor today or visit vaccinateall58.com to learn more, so you can feel good about the fact. Brought to you by the California Department of Public Health.
Before I started Rooter Hill Plumbing, I was an angry young man. Hello, I'm John McClane. I was angry because my dad died when I was 17 and he left me alone. I was